Welcome to the Creative Obsession Podcast. My name is Carrie, and I am coming to you from just outside of Portland, Oregon. Today is April 27th. It's a Thursday, 2017. We didn't go camping, so I'm here recording. And we didn't go camping because it's been real rainy. We are still waiting for spring to kick in. This morning even, it was super frosty. So we aren't really into spring yet. We're trying really hard. I mean, it is spring. There's leaves coming on the trees and some flowers are blooming, but we've still just been pretty cool and rainy, really, really rainy. So we didn't go camping. No matter where we looked at going in the state, pretty much everywhere was raining. So we just stayed home. You can find me on Instagram and Ravelry. I'll put the information on the screen. I also have an Etsy shop where I sell hand-dyed yarn and project bags. That will also be on the screen. I will put links and show notes in the description box below this YouTube video. So if there's something that I talk about that you want to go check out, hopefully I remember to put everything down there and you can just click on it and go take a look. So I'd like to start, like I always do, talking about the quilt that I have on the wall behind me. This quilt is very large because it is made for my bed and it's a king size bed, so it's really huge. So I couldn't hang it on the wall because it's just too big and heavy. So I have it draped over a like a room partitioner thing. So that is the quilt I like to put on my bed come spring when the weather gets warmer. Someday it's going to get warmer. And have it on my bed through the summer. I made this a few years ago because if you've been watching me for a while, you know I haven't been making quilts very much lately. So I made this with this pattern. It's from So Kind of Wonderful, and it's Urban Abacus. And I got really excited when Jenny Pedigo, who is the designer of the pattern, she came up with a ruler that does this curved piecing. So none of that is applique, it's all actually pieced in. And curves can be tricky, but she came up with the quick curve ruler, which I know it's hard to see. It's just hard to see. You have to look it up. It's got this slit right here that you cut your pieces with. And she's got really great directions on where to place the ruler to get just the right shape and size and all that stuff. And I really, really got excited about the curved piecing. I liked curved piecing, and this ruler makes this really easy because the curve is really gentle. It's still, you know, it's not something that's super fast. I mean, you have to take time to do it, but it is pretty easy. And it was funny because I was right at the beginning of the time when I was really getting, kind of losing my love for quilting. I just wasn't feeling excited about anything that was out there. Didn't feel like anybody was doing anything new. There weren't any really fun, interesting patterns coming out. Fabric wasn't inspiring me. And I was just kind of losing my love for it. And then this came out and it sparked a new love. Like I got really excited to, because of the possibilities of some different things that you could do with this. And so when I was pulling out, trying to look for the pattern so I could tell you what the pattern was and I wanted to show the ruler, I actually realized that I have a quilt in progress using that ruler. Jenny Pedigo is the designer. And she has a blog. I don't follow it anymore, so I'm assuming her blog is still there. And so she, when the ruler was still pretty new, she put out a block of the month kind of a thing. I don't remember if it was once a month or every couple of weeks. And she'd give you a pattern and directions on how to make different blocks, kind of taking a traditional block and putting a curve to it and changing it around. And it was just really cool. And so it was early on when I was experimenting with more modern colors and a more modern aesthetic. And so I started following it and I was doing it. And I was pretty much keeping up with it. And then she came out with a couple blocks that were like, yeah, I don't really like it too much. And then I got busy doing other things, put it away. Completely forgot about it. But I think I'm going to finish it. I've made 7 blocks, and I think if I make 12 blocks, I can get a decent-sized lap quilt. So I wanted to show you some of the blocks. This was one that was based off of a log cabin. And the blocks are really big. They're like 16-inch blocks. So here's your log cabin right here in this corner, and then you add a curve to it. You put four of them together and you've got that really cool kind of a star effect. So that's that one. I'm just going to go through these really quick. That one. That was taking a rail fence and putting a curve to it. A rail fence is just strips of fabric, and you usually go this way, and you just do it as a curve. So because she had blocks that I didn't really care for, I think what I'm going to do, I have to go through it. I printed off all of them, and I'm glad I did because I don't think it's available anymore for free. I think it's actually a paid pattern. That's a churn dash if you're familiar with quilt blocks. So I think for the other five, I may duplicate some of these and not do the ones that I thought were kind of ugly. That's a pinwheel. That's real pretty. So if I finish five more blocks, that's just a four patch. I like that one. That's pretty cool. And there's the last one, a sawtooth star. Very cool looking. I think it will make a really, really pretty quilt. Just do some sashing in between to kind of separate those. She even had a tutorial on making a curved piece to sashing. I think I need to finish that because now that I took it out and was reminded of it, I'm like, that's really cool. I would really like to have that as a finished quilt. So I know I say I'm going to finish things, and you guys, I do finish things. I don't finish as many things as I want to, but I'm going to leave this one out so that I don't forget about it again and get that finished. I just have a hard time carving out time for it because I've found that if I am going to sit and sew, I'm sewing project bags and I'm not necessarily sewing a quilt for myself. So I got to figure that out, how to make that happen, because there's just so many things I want to do and there's just only so much time. And Jim and I were sitting there talking, and I said, oh, I was thinking, like, what if I did this? What if I did that? And he goes, when are you going to have time to do that? I thought, yeah, you're right. But what if I did? I think this would be really cool if I did this. And he goes, when are you going to have time to do that? So I can't add more to what I do. I have to, if I'm going to do something, I have to take something away because there's still only so much time. And I do still want a podcast because I do enjoy that. And that is an entire day for me by the time I set it up, record it, edit it, get it uploaded. And I'm not going to give that up. I still want to dye yarn. I still want to make project bags. I still want to do things for myself. I want to have time to sit and knit. That's why it seems like I don't get things done because I have a lot of things I'm trying to get done. Anyway, kind of went off on a little tangent. Sorry about that. So that is my curved piecing saga. I want to now talk about the cal that I'm co-hosting. So if you remember, I'm ho co-hosting with Tracy of the Thimble and Thread Make podcast. Check her out. She's got a good podcast. And we are doing the springtime single skein shawl cal using the hashtag SSSSKAL. And the idea is to make a springtime lightweight shawl using one skein of fingering weight yarn. So I haven't gotten a whole lot done on mine just due to the other things that I have been working on, but I will show you. So I'm making the Stargazer shawl by Marsha Ibuki, who is Fairy Little. And let me get a picture of it for you. Sorry, I should have had that ready. So there's the Stargazer shawl. I'm at the point, I'm kind of in the middle of it. Right about here's where I last showed you. So I haven't gotten a ton done, just because I've actually been crocheting more, to be honest. I've been doing a lot of crochet, and when I am knitting, I'm trying to get my socks done for the sock cal. So anyway, it's coming along. I think it's just looking really cool. To remind you, in case you didn't catch a previous episode, I am knitting it off of a sock blank. So cool. I'm hoping to get it done. The cow ends the middle of May. I have prizes, and I've posted what prizes there are in the Rav group, and I want to show you a prize that I just got donated. Just got it in the mail the other day. Let me show you what I got sent. Irina, who is on Instagram, and we follow each other, and she offered to send something for a prize, and I thought, okay, thank you. You know, I appreciate it. And she sent all this stuff. I was floored. For when I get this box, cool box. I mean, like, she put cute tape and everything. I'm like, this is coming from overseas. What did I order? Did I order something I forgot I ordered? And then I opened it up and it was all these goodies. So it's all these really wonderful little notion-y things from Hiya Hiya. Oops, sorry. They're Hiya Hiya, like little stitch markers, little scissors, cable needles, needle. What do you call these? Needle gauge. So you can tell like how big your needles are. A couple of those, stitch markers, point protectors, stitch holders. I mean, she sent a ton of stuff. Another little needle gauge deal, a couple of pairs of scissors. So I'm gonna add. I mean, it was very generous, and Irina, thank you so much. You went above and beyond. But I'm gonna put those in. Some of that stuff in with some of the other prizes, like Lee donated a drawstring bag that I showed last time, I think, and I'll put some of these things in with the drawstring bag. And I may keep some of them for future giveaways because that was just a lot, and that was really cool. The fun thing about the cowl, I mean, I don't know if I'm gonna get finished in time for my own cowl. Big surprise. I'm trying. But the fun thing is to see the other patterns that other people are making. And it's just adding more stuff to my queue because I think, oh yeah, that's a really cool pattern. And that's a cool pattern. So if you go to the Thimble and Thread Make podcast group on Ravelry or my group, you can see the patterns that people are making. And there's some really nice looking patterns that if you've just got that one skein of yarn that is kind of special or doesn't go with anything else. There's some things you can make with that, some really, really fun things. So I do appreciate those of you that are participating. It's been fun. It's been fun. So right around the middle of May, we'll close that and offer prizes, and we've got a couple pattern giveaways, and it's good. And I appreciate any of the donations that have been made. I really do. I'm very touched by the generosity of people donating either pattern or products. I do really appreciate it. I wanted to share something with you that I'm pretty excited about. I started a knit night. We don't have a yarn store or anything like that in my area. We have to go into Portland, which is a good half hour, 40 minutes, to go to a yarn shop. And so I wanted to try and get together with people in my area. I know that there's people that knit and crochet out here and just craft in general. And so I thought, well, you know what? I'm just going to try it. So I put it out online. There's a an app that just recently started covering our area called Nextdoor, and I thought, I'm just going to put it on there. Is there a knit night going on? Because I thought maybe there's one going on and I just don't know. And so several people commented like, no, but I'd like to go if there is one. And I got several comments like that. And there didn't seem to be one already going. So I thought, okay, I need to start one. I didn't want to have it at my house, and I didn't really want to have it at anybody else's house. I wanted to have it someplace public because you just don't always want to go to somebody's house, and it's kind of a hassle. You got to make sure your house is clean, and then, you know, what if somebody's there and you just can't get rid of them or whatever? It's like if it's in a public place, it's just good. So I searched around. I don't have a lot to choose from. I live in a small town. I even searched the town kind of next to me, and what I came up with was using the meeting room at my local library. And so we had our first meetup. We had 10 of us there for our first time, which I thought was really pretty good. And we're calling it a knit night just because it's easier to say, and just kind of it's kind of catchy. But I said, if somebody said, well, I embroider, I'm like, come on down, come and do it. So we had somebody that embroiders, we had a couple people that were crocheting, couple people that were knitting. There was a gentleman there, which I was really pleased to see, and he is a basket weaver. And so he sat and was weaving baskets, and I hope that he'll kind of, as we get to know each other a little bit more and kind of get a feel for how this is going to go, that he'll even do like a demonstration on how to do it. So it was like different crafts. Everybody just, nobody really knew anybody. I knew Kathy and Lucy because they're people that I knew from quilting, and they came, and it was really nice to have friendly faces. Not that nobody, and I shouldn't say friendly faces. Everybody was really friendly, just somebody that I knew. And it was really successful. We laughed. We all seemed to get along. Everybody chatted and got to know each other. And so we're going to make it a regular thing. So it was just, if you're thinking that that would be something you would like to do, do it. I mean, find a place. We don't really have a coffee shop, although a new coffee shop is being built. I mean, the building's there, but they're coming into town. And so it'll be interesting to see if maybe that's a place where we can meet. But this was really nice. We set up some tables because it was kind of nice to plop your stuff down on a table and sat around tables. It's air conditioned. It's easy access. So it was really nice to have it there. But yeah, find a place. Sometimes fire departments will have a meeting room that you can use, and find a way to put it out there, Facebook or Nextdoor or some other way to put it out there. And I bet you, if you don't have a knit night going on, there's people that would love to join one. So I'm really glad that I did. I'm really happy that it was as successful as it was, and I feel like I'm meeting some new friends. And so we're going to meet every couple of weeks. Once a week, I think, is a little too much as far as a commitment. For me, being that I'm kind of hosting it, I don't want to make that kind of commitment right now. I'm hoping that as time goes on, and this is another reason why I wanted to have it in a public place. If I don't feel like going, or for some reason I'm busy, I'm camping, I'm whatever, it can still happen. It can still happen without me. And so having it in a public place allows the freedom for it to continue on, even if I'm not there. So yeah, we're going to meet every couple of weeks, and it should be really fun. It was really, I'm really glad that I kind of put myself out there to do it, because it was a really good turnout, and everybody really seemed to be glad that it was happening. So that was really cool. Let me go into what I've been crocheting. So I've been crocheting a lot, and I haven't talked about my one project, the crocheted blanket that I'm making, and I'm making it for a wedding present, and it's the trust blanket, and it's a blanket that you crochet blocks, like bricks, and it has popcorn stitches is what she calls them. They're like baubles, and that makes words, and then when you put it all together, it has the same. And I've really been working a lot on that because, let me see, my shoulder's really sore from painting. I can't reach very far. I've been working a lot on it because I kind of think I might be able to get it done by the wedding. The wedding is in like 4 more weeks. I might be able to get it done. So here's one of the blocks. Hopefully you can see. So these baubles make up the word. And I've been really fun to work on. I have really enjoyed it. And I've been getting a lot of the blocks. This one was one. This was a big one. Let me turn it this way. And I kept putting it off because I'm like, oh, that's going to be hard to follow because you have to follow written instructions. And so keeping track of where you are. It was actually one of the easiest ones to do. So I've been putting a lot of this, put a lot of my effort into this because I need to get it done. Do I have it the right way up? Nope. Upside down. You see that? So it's been really fun. I'm really hoping that I can get it done by the wedding. I would easily make another one, giving myself lots of time to do it, because it is time consuming in the fact that it's not just simple, just crochet across a thing. You're following a pattern, and doing the bobble stitches takes a little extra time because it's like 4 stitches in one. But I've really, really been enjoying it. Another thing that I've been crocheting, I wanted to knit myself some dishcloths. And I had made a bunch of dishcloths at Christmas time. And it was, I liked it. And I really liked the knitted ones because I liked the fabric that it made. But I found it to be really hard on my hands. My hands got really sore, And I didn't enjoy the process as much because my hands got really sore. And I was watching a new to me podcast, and it's the Addie Day Designs podcast. That's Deanne. She's in Australia. I had heard about her through Shara of the Shara Made podcast. And she's also out of Australia, and I really enjoy her podcast as well. She also is a designer. But anyway, for some reason, the Addie Day Designs podcast came up as a like watch next kind of thing or something. And she had done a dishcloth using what I think was called the moss stitch. So I looked it up to see what it was. She did hers on the diagonal, and I don't know how to do that because I don't really know how to crochet. I say that, I'm making a blanket. This is only single crochet and then the bobble stitches. That's all it is. It's super easy. So you go straight, you make so many stitches, I can do that. Going on a diagonal is going to be a little trickier. So anyway, I just looked on YouTube and found a pattern for the crocheted moss stitch. I had this leftover cotton from when I made dishcloths. It's pouring right now. For when I made dishcloths at Christmas time. And I thought, well, let me try it. And it worked up really fast. It was not hard on my hands. I do like the texture. It is a little holier than knitting, but it is, this stitch did seem to make a denser fabric and a smoother fabric. I tried another one. I just searched on YouTube. I think I put in dense fabric, crocheted dense fabric or something like that. And I found a channel called Be Hooked. And she did this stitch, and I don't remember what she called it. And I thought, okay, let me try that. And this does also make a nice dense stitch, but it is a little knobbier. I liked working this stitch better. This was a lot easier for me to work, but both of these were really good. So that was good. So now I have a couple of dishcloths. Doesn't exactly match my kitchen, but what do you care? It's washing dishes. Who cares? And then one time when I was watching, it's been a few episodes ago, Amber of the Yarn Hoarder podcast, and she had talked about crocheting scrubbies. And I thought, well, that's interesting. Maybe that's, you know, I'm always looking for what can I do as a little Christmas gift or a little giveaway gift or something. So this is Red Heart Yarn, and it's their scrubby yarn, and it's a polyester, with these little, it's like hairy. And so I looked on YouTube, and I don't really remember whose YouTube video I followed. Did I look on YouTube? I don't remember now. But I made a scrubby. And it was pretty easy. It's not as rough on your hands to work with it as you think it will be. I don't know that I'll be making a ton of these, though. I do have the skinny yarn and quite a bit left from this. And I don't know what I'm going to use this for because I don't have food that sticks. And if it does, I let it soak. But anyway, I made one. And I even thought, well, maybe I could use this in the shower because I like to use a puff thing. Maybe I could use this in the shower. Well, it doesn't really work the same as a puff. And it's a little bit rough, but I exfoliated really, really well. So anyway, just trying some different things, just trying what I can make with crochet, because sometimes my hands need a break from knitting because just my arthritis and stuff gets sore. So I've been doing a lot more crochet lately than knitting because of the blanket. I really want to try and get that done. And then as soon as that blanket's done, I've got yarn and plans to make, to crochet a corner-to-corner baby blanket for somebody that's having a little girl. And I will talk about that when I get closer to actually starting it. Focusing on this one for now. So it's coming together. Fingers crossed. I can only do so much. So let's talk about some knitting, shall we? So last episode I talked about wanting to knit a sweater. And I have, where did I go with this? This Bamboo Pop. It's really raining. Is it hailing? Oh my gosh. Whatever. got this bamboo pop yarn, and I am part of Christy from the Relatively Crafty podcast is doing a spring, summer, what did she call it? Lightweight garment knit along thing. I don't know that I'm going to join the knit along because I'm finding I don't like the pressure of having to work on something. And I think part of it comes from, for so many years as a long arm quilter, I had to work on stuff whether I wanted to or not, whether I was inspired by it or not. And I had to do that for 11 years is one of the reasons why I stopped doing it. And I don't really feel like I want to do that anymore. I want to work on stuff that I'm inspired to work on and that I feel like I want to work on and not do stuff just because I have to, because I've done that. I don't want to do it anymore. I don't have to. But anyway, so I was going to make out of that yarn this sweater by Heidi Kermeyer called Sunshine Coast. And it is an A-line sweater. It calls for DK weight yarn, which is what this bamboo pop stuff is. And I did good. I did a swatch. And I want to talk about that. So because the sweater is knit in the round, I knew I needed to swatch in the round. Because when you're knitting in the round, you're not, well, for this particular sweater, you're not purling. You're just knitting. And if you just make a square and you knit and then you purl and then you knit and you purl, your gauge is going to be different than if you're just knitting in the round like you would if you're making the sweater. So I knit in the round, and one of the things that I was so thankful for this tip, Zoe of the Pins and Needles podcast, watch her podcast too because she's got a good one. Zoe commented that the bamboo cotton yarn may stretch lengthwise, and so she suggested hanging it because when you have the garment, the weight of the garment could stretch out. So I knitted a swatch, and then I laid it out flat to dry, and I just knitted a little bit, and I'll show you in a second here. I knit a little swatch, laid it flat like I would if I were to wash a sweater. I'm just going to lay it out flat to dry. I'm not going to pin it out. I'm just going to let it lay flat. Once it was dry, I then hung it up on with chip clips. So this is my swatch. So this is giving it just a little bit of weight to pull it and see if it stretches. It's not a very big piece, so I didn't know really how else to give it that hang. So then what I did, so now I can take it off. So I just did this swatch. I did it in the round. And I don't know, figured out how many stitches I needed and whatnot. And so my gauge is correct. My gauge is correct both stitch-wise and row-wise. Row-wise, I might be maybe a half a stitch. It needs to be seven rows to the inch. And I was getting like 7.5 to 8 rows to the inch, which means it's a little shorter, which I think will be good because if it then does stretch more, it'll fit. But stitch-wise, going across, I was right on. So I'm going to leave this attached to the ball. I'm going to leave it attached to the ball. And then I will start using the other yarn and the other balls, and then if I need to go to this, I'll see how much more I need. I might just snip this off and continue with this ball, or if I need it, I'll unravel it. But I don't really think I used all that much yarn, but I don't know if I'm gonna need, like, you know, you start playing yarn chicken, that might be what saves your butt. So I'm excited to get that started. I feel good that I did my gauge swatch. I with the recommended needle size, I got what I should get. Which I find is pretty typical. I'm an average knitter. I don't knit tight. I don't knit loose. I seem to knit to gauge generally, but I think it was good that I tried the gauge and that I did that. And because I'm going to put a lot into it to make a sweater. When I bought the pattern, it's my first sweater. So for those of you that haven't been watching, I've never knit a sweater before. So I don't think this gives anything. This is just about gauge and stuff. So I start reading this, and then you've got to put a marker here and a marker there, and And oh, like this little diagram there, and I thought, oh my goodness, what did I get myself into? But I think if I just take it one step at a time, one stitch at a time, it should all come together, because I'm not the first one to knit this pattern, which is something I looked for, is something that's been knit a few times, that's got a few projects, so that you know it's kind of tried and true. And if there's been any issues with anything, somebody's already kind of figured that out. So I'm going to get that started soon. Probably before the next time I see you, because I may just need something different to start. I have been really fighting casting stuff on, because there's been some fun designs that have come out. There's fun yarn, and I just think, oh, I got to put these colors together and I need to make something. And I'm really sitting on my hands on not casting a bunch of stuff on, because then that just makes me feel too scattered. And then I don't feel like I'm getting anything done, more so than normal. Remember my sock debacle? Oh, the sock debacle. I had started doing, what was it called? Ugly Duckling socks. And it just wasn't working out. I got it past the heel, and then I realized it was just too tight. I think that was the problem. Anyway, I put it aside. I had to just put it away, because I just didn't know what to do with it, and I was frustrated, and I thought, don't make any rash decisions. Just let it sit, let it be in timeout, and then figure out what you're going to do from there. So meanwhile, because I was really trying to get a pair of socks done a month, it's not going to happen this month, because I knit most of the sock on the, I don't even know where it is anymore. I knit most of the sock, took it out because I realized it was too tight, started it back again, got the leg all done, realized it's still not going to fit. So that was almost two socks right there. And so then I started another pair of socks. I got one done, and this is yarn. Oh, let me show you the sock. I'm doing vanilla sock, because I know vanilla works. Vanilla, I can go fast. My socks are my relaxing knit. They're not something that I want to count. They're not something I want to follow a chart. I just want to sit and knit. And especially if I'm watching something that I really kind of have to watch, because I can, for a lot of it, just knit without looking. And when you're knitting any special stitches, I can't do that. So I got one sock done. This is yarn from Yarn Cafe Creations. I got the cuff started on the next one. So there's the ball of yarn. I showed it last time. This is, I'm going to give you the Kelpie. 75% superwash South American wool and 25% nylon. 100 grams, 437 yards. From Yarn Cafe Creations. I'll put the link below. Fun colors, kind of springy, Eastery, you know, because we did just have Easter. It's South American wool, so it is a little bit scratchier, but it feels fine on my feet. It feels fine. I wouldn't want to do anything that I was actually, like, it wouldn't wear it anywhere around my neck, or I probably wouldn't even do mitts or anything with it, but on my feet, it's cool. So I got one sock done. Today's the 27th, which means there's 3 days left in the month. Not going to get another sock done, because that's as far as I am. Guaranteed. Not going to finish another sock in 3 days, because I got too many other things to do. But I got a sock done. So I feel really disappointed in myself that I didn't do it, because I really wanted to try and get a pair of socks done a month. But, you know, it just didn't happen. And so I have to let it go. What's I going to look at? Oh, okay. Sorry, distracting myself. So one pair of one sock, not even a pair, but it's a hoe, whatever. I think I'm going to stick with vanilla. And you know, I was watching Relatively Crafty's latest episode, and I haven't gotten all the way through it, but at one point she talked about, she knits a ton of socks. I know, Christy, you say you don't knit 10 pairs of socks a month, but come on, girl, pretty close. She knits a lot of socks. And one thing she said is she likes to do vanilla socks. And they're just, that's where she's comfortable and what she enjoys making. And I thought, you know what? Me too. I like the look of the pattern socks. I really do. And I see people making these gorgeous socks and all kinds of patterns and stuff. And I think it'd be so fun. And it just doesn't seem to work out for me. I did buy Mina's. Mina of the Knitting Expat had a New York collection of patterns, and I bought the collection of patterns. And so I have them. They will be in my library. Someday I might make one of those. But otherwise, I think I'm going to stick with vanilla. It's my relaxing knit, and I just need to let it be that and not try and have it be anything else. That's for today. Who knows what's going to happen tomorrow? I might change my mind. But today, that's where I'm at. I'm going to stick with vanilla because I know I can do it and I know it fits, and that's important. Something I wanted to show you guys, and I did post it on Instagram, and it's not necessarily knitting related, but kind of sorta. I have a friend who does drawings and stuff, and she's always posting her little sketches and things on Instagram or on Facebook. She's not on Instagram. Hopefully she'll get on Instagram soon. But anyway, she just does these drawings for fun, for passing the time, and she started doing like steampunk type drawings. And I just love them. They're so clever and so good. And I approached her. I said, "Hey, would you be interested in doing a commission job for me?" So she was all about it. And I said, "I just something with either an alpaca or a sheep and just like knitting related." And that's the only instructions I gave her. And so then, and I've got just framed it. I haven't hung it up yet because I don't know where I'm putting it. But this is what she made. So it's an alpaca, it's a steampunk alpaca picture. And she put in some knitting needles over here on this side and a ball of yarn and some scissors. And she even put some sewing stuff in there. And just, it's all done with pen and pencil. And I love it. I just love it. And so I got this frame. Okay, that hurts my shoulder. Oh, sorry. My shoulder's really sore. I got this frame at Michael's. I got it on sale with the coupon, so it was pretty inexpensive. And it's basically just two pieces of glass with no mat because she did the drawing on watercolor paper, I think, or sketch paper. I'm not sure which, but it's an odd size. And I didn't want to cut any of it out by putting a mat over it to make it fit like a standard size. So I found this frame, which just is glass. And so I'm trying to find the right wall where I want to hang it so that it, because you'll see the wall color behind it and like where will this go? It'll pretty much go anywhere, but isn't that just the coolest? I was just so tickled. She did such a fabulous job. I've got ideas of other ones I want her to do. I even thought it would be kind of cool if she could do something. Well, I'm not gonna say anything yet because if I end up doing it, I don't want to put that idea out there. So anyway, she may do some more for me in the future, hopefully, because I think it's pretty cool and it's just unique. I do want to talk about a couple of podcasts that are new to me or newish to me that I've been watching, and sometimes I just forget to mention them. One of them is the Addie Day Designs podcast that I just mentioned. She is mostly a crocheter, but she does some knitting. But she's got a really sweet personality, and it's just fun to see people doing different things. So that's Deanne over at Addie Day Designs. Another one is Hand Me My Knitting with Sam. She's a oh God, where is she from? Is she in Canada? Seems like a lot of the ones I watch are in Canada. Anyway, she's from somewhere. She's recently started hand dyeing yarn, and so kind of the experimentation with that as well. So, no, is she the one that dyes yarn? Crap, now I don't remember. Right, there was another one that I started. Yes, no, Sam doesn't dye yarn. Did she start dyeing yarn? Having this conversation with myself. I'm glad you could join me. Anyway, go check them out. Hand Me My Knitting and Addie Day Designs. Those are two newish podcasts that you should go check out because I like them. I want to now go into what I've got new for the shop. I've got some project bags and some new colorways of yarn. So if you're not into that, I appreciate you being here this far, and I hope to see you back here next time. If you're interested in what's going up new in the shop, then stick around. Okay, new in the shop. I had talked about making some tote bags, and I've even posted a little bit on Instagram, but I've made these tote bags. I'm having a hard time holding it up because my shoulder's sore, but made these with these cute little whimsical trailers on it. Happy camper, enjoy the ride. I've got the black vinyl on the bottom. And sorry, that was probably loud. I still need to put the snaps on them yet, so that they're still a work in progress. But it's got a turquoise aqua polka dot in the middle with pockets. So that I have 6 of those made. I don't have any more of the vinyl. I can make a few more, I think. So we'll see if this even sells. I can do it with just black fabric on the bottom. But I like the vinyl. And I did cut the fabric in a way because it was directional, but I was able to get some fabric to make some drawstring bags out of it. So that will be coming up in the future. I haven't started those yet other than them being cut out. So tote size project bag. I have got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like 5 or 6 skeins in here. And then you could still fit a project. So let me show you some of the new colors I have. This one is a beautiful purpley lilac color. It's got a little punch of orange and there's some little bit of green in there. I don't have a name for this yet, so it's not in the shop yet until I figure out a name. So this is called Just Peachy. Just a peach color with some speckles of purple and pink and aqua. This one is chestnut. Okay, so this is such a rich color, and I hope it shows up on the screen or on the video. I had a dark brown that I had was teddy bear, and I tweaked the formula a little bit, and I got a richer, deeper color. And so this is a chestnut color because it's got a little bit of a reddish brown kind of highlight in it. This goes with so many things. I mean, you put it with anything and it's going to go. So this is chestnut. This is another new one. It's got some light orange, some chartreuse green, a little bit of speckling of like a purpley plum color. Don't have a name for this one yet either. So that one's waiting to go in the shop. Then this one is, this is a colorway. Excuse me. Colorway that I came up with. I designed a colorway for my friend Lori for her birthday, and I took the colors that she likes, and she likes red and she likes teal and turquoise, and she likes a lot of colors. So I came up with this colorway called Celebration. So it was for Lori's birthday, inspired by that, and so that color is now in my shop as Celebration. So I'm gonna continue doing some dyeing. And I got to finish up these tote bags, put the snaps on them, get pictures taken of them, get them posted, and those will be in the shop. I've updated some of my signature colors, and I've just updated those in the shop as they get low. And it's really hard to know which ones to dye next, because something can sit there for a while and you think, well, that wasn't a color that people liked. And then all of a sudden they like it. So I don't know. I wait to see if things sell. And if it looks like the stock's getting low, then I'll dye some more. Don't ever hesitate to contact me if there's a color that you see that you think you might want to make something of, or I may not have enough of in the shop. A lot of times it's because I'm currently going to be dyeing it, or maybe not, but the fact that you want it, I'll dye it for you. Thank you so much for joining me and sticking with me this far. Please subscribe if you've liked what you've seen, and that way you know when another video will come up. Give me a thumbs up, boosts me up to be more visible to other people. I appreciate you being here and joining me. So I will see you next time, and have a good couple of weeks.